Thanks for joining us today for Cardiology VMR. We're so excited to have you all join us today. And we have a special guest, Dr. Karan Desai, representing the cardio nerds, and also he's going to be our expert discussant. So we're really excited to have a cardiology case today. And my name is, I forgot to introduce myself. My name is Verlene. I'm an intern at Brigham in Boston. And I'm excited to present the case. And if any of you want to join in and discuss the case with Karan, feel free to put that in the chat. Again, this is a safe space for everyone. So anyone who wants to discuss is welcome to join in. Super safe space. And I'll pass it on to Karan to introduce himself.
Hi, everybody. My name is Karan. I am teaming up here with a true expert. I'm a learner like the rest of you, but the expert is Gerlene. And I'm going to try to talk through my thought process. And I'm a cardiology fellow, third year fellow at the University of Maryland, and also on the Cardio Nerds team. And I'm just excited to learn with you. But mainly, if there's a chance to hang out with Gerlene, I try to do it. So that's what I'm most excited about here. So Gerlene, I am ready whenever you are.
Yeah, we can start sharing the screen for scribing, and I can give the first aliquot. And if someone wants to jump in later on in the case to discuss or put your thoughts in the chat, active participation is great. So I can start once we have the screen shared.
As we're waiting for the screen to be shared, I think Gerlene's futon or couch there is probably the coolest looking futon or couch I've seen. So I enjoy that as the background already.
Thanks. Daniela, do you want to go ahead and share your screen?
That was my fault. I didn't make her co-host, so it was error.
Panic in the background, but yeah, let's go ahead and do this.
Sorry, my mouse dysfunctioned and then I wasn't able to click unmute, but I have her case. So this is a 79-year-old male who came in from a neighboring hospital for out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. So he was watching TV when he developed sudden onset of chest pain, became diaphoretic and collapsed at that time. His wife was there and called EMS. And when EMS got there, he was found to be in BFib cardiac arrest. He was shocked three times and also got amiodarone during the process and then had spontaneous return of spontaneous circulation. He was intubated on field by EMS and it was unclear how long he was down at home. And then I'll give some more information about the past medical history in this aliquot as well. So he has a past medical history of type 2 diabetes, hyperlipidemia, hypertension, coronary artery disease, peripheral artery disease with stable intermittent claudication, as well as carotid artery disease. He's had a carotid endarterectomy a few years ago and also has a history of frequent PVCs. He had a Holter monitor a few months ago that showed a 4.8% burden of PVCs. And then just some more cardiac relevant history before I end this aliquot. So he had an echo around a year and a half ago, which showed a left ventricular EF of 62%, normal left ventricular systolic function, but some mild valvular aortic stenosis. He also had a stress test, a myocardial SPECT, around 4 years ago, which he had achieved 8 METs on that stress test, and the myocardial perfusion has shown no ischemia and no other abnormalities. And then the last piece is he had a cath around 15 years ago, which showed moderate disease of his first diagonal. And I'll pass it on to Karan to discuss this piece of information.
You know, Gerlene, as you were telling that story, I was thinking, you know, does this sound like the every single 15 patients that are currently in our CCU? You know, this is a very common presentation that, and as I can see in the chat, people are saying typical for myocardial infarction. So let's talk about that here for a second. So when you say 79-year-old gentleman, extensive cardiovascular history, known history of peripheral arterial disease, PVCs, with sudden chest pain and VFib arrest, that's what we're being told from the field, is that we clearly think that coronary artery disease is on top of our differential. But why don't we take a step back and just define what that syndrome is that we're talking about here? And the syndrome is sudden cardiac arrest in an elderly gentleman with cardiac risk factors. And so when I start to think about sudden cardiac arrest, some of the things that I'm thinking about are certainly, of course, coronary disease on top of it, but I like to take a step back. You know, the further along you get in your training, the further you're removed, especially in subspecialty, from that initial primary data. And so I like to just take a moment, go through that entire process. So of course, the first things that we're gonna do for someone that has VFib arrest, which EMS did in the field, is they're gonna ensure that we restore circulation, we have our airway, we have breathing, which was done at that time. My immediate thought when you were telling me with the story, Gerlene, was not only just management right off the, I mean, not only diagnosis, was quickly thinking through management. And those first two quick management questions that I began to think about is this, a patient that needs to go to the catheterization lab for a coronary evaluation? And also, is this patient going to need mechanical support to get them through whatever is happening at this time? So those are two primary questions that I think about right away. And then I start to think about, okay, what was the cause of the sudden cardiac arrest? And is there a trigger for the underlying pathology this patient has? So let me talk to that through just a second. And Gerlene, I won't take too long because I know I'm sure you got more aliquots of information, but I think it's important kind of just to frame what we're going through here. So when I think sudden cardiac arrest, the causes of it, there are about four main categories that I think about. And we're clearly thinking about the primary one here is coronary disease. When you look at epidemiologic studies around, I believe 70, 80% of sudden cardiac arrest. And that could be when we say it, it typically is ventricular fibrillation or ventricular tachycardia, but that does include other rhythm disturbances, is coronary disease. Amongst the next potential category is cardiomyopathy. When I talk about cardiomyopathy, we're talking about dilated cardiomyopathy, myocarditis, you know, stress, ACM, ARVC, which is arrhythmogenic, arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, peripartum or inherited cardiomyopathies. And you mentioned that this is a patient with a normal ejection fraction in the past. So maybe a dilated cardiomyopathy is probably not on my differential. And of course, all those coronary risk factors are part of it. But if you had described to me as this is someone with a structurally normal heart, someone that has no coronary disease history, that has no cardiomyopathy history, I would have turned to start thinking about some of those other categories. And they're much lower in my differential, but those other categories include things like channelopathies. So let's say you told me this was a young patient that was exercising and then suddenly passed out and was found to have VFib arrest. You know, some of the things I may think about was a Brugada or a long QT syndrome, specifically a long QT1. And then there's the other categories, and of course, including things like toxins. Let's say this is someone with a psychiatric illness as on TCA. Maybe this could be TCA toxicity. It could be electrolytes and so forth. So broadly thinking, top of my differential, it is very, very, very high pretest probability that this patient has had an acute coronary event. And my question specifically is this an acute coronary event that's an occlusive MI leading to a STEMI that needs to go to the cath lab right at this moment?
Nice to see you. Good to see you.
So those are my initial thoughts.
Mango chips we have at home.
Great, that was great. Thanks for walking us through the different categories. So just to give some more information about his social history, he's a former 10-pack year smoking history, no alcohol or drug use. In terms of his medications, he's on amlodipine, aspirin, atorvastatin, lisinopril, metformin, metoprolol, and omeprazole. And then I can give some initial vitals when he had presented to the neighboring hospital emergency department, as well as some initial labs at that time. So his vitals then were,
Really, just before, just to point to the medication list, because again, the pretest probability is very high for us. But if you're thinking about other potential causes, what I laid out what the potential pathology could be. So this patient could have underlying cardiomyopathy, but thinking about a trigger you always think about medications that could lead to an electrolyte disturbance or a long QT that could prime a substrate that's ready to have VT, VFib, so forth into that realm. So, one of the things I was paying attention to is this patient on a diuretic, could they, or HCTZ, is that something that could have driven their potassium extremely low? Maybe this is not an acute coronary event, but they had hypokalemia. They have a substrate prone to developing VT or VF. This is described as VF in the field. This is secondhand information. So we'll go with it. But again, you always have to confirm it. And so those are a couple things I was just paying attention to there. Sorry to interrupt.
Yeah. So when he had presented to the neighboring hospital emergency department, his heart rate at that time had been 82. Blood pressure was 142 over 64, and he had been intubated. And at that time, his initial labs were notable for creatinine of 1.4, potassium of 3.9, lactate of 5.6, ALT of 223, AST of 181, white blood cell count of 17, hemoglobin 15.7, and his troponin started off as 21, and then it went up to 65 and then 240.
Excellent. Do you want me to react to this aliquot of information, or did you want to
give? Yeah, I was just going to give the chest x-ray that was reported from the outside hospital showed possible pneumonia. I don't have the physical exam from there, but I'll give I wanted to share the EKG from the outside hospital and then give the physical exam when you presented to our CCU.
Okay. Give that information, just a couple quick things on the vitals, right? So this is someone that has had VFib arrest with extensive coronary disease history, and now is presented to an outside hospital, unclear downtime. They're now in this outside ED with a heart rate of 82 and a blood pressure of 142 over 62. Again, one of my initial questions was, does this patient need to go to the emergently to the cardiac catheterization lab? And do they need mechanical support inherent to that question, or is the patient in cardiogenic shock? Now the lactate is elevated, but it's discrepant with someone's heart rate and their blood pressure. And this presumably on not any medical support. And I don't think you mentioned that the patient on vasopressor medication and so forth. So while that lactate is elevated, I think it is I'm feeling slightly reassured by the vital signs that we have some time to make some of these decisions and go through the EKG. So go ahead, Gerlene, if you wanted to show that EKG. And that troponin in the 240s is quite narrows the differential of diagnosis considerably. Only a few things, especially related to the coronaries, drive troponins that high.
Yeah, I'm having some difficulty moving my mouse to share the screen, but Daniela, if you want to share the EKG I sent you on the case, you can just zoom into it.
Okay, just give me 1 second.
Yeah, sure.
And while the EKG is being brought up, Gerlene, do you know how long after the time that the patient had ROSC or return of spontaneous circulation, the EKG was obtained?
I'm not sure of the time frame. I think he had ROSC in at the site when EMS had gotten there, and then the EKG I have was when he had presented to the ED, so I'm not sure how long that took.
Okay.
I think Brody has volunteered to take kind of the first interpretation of the ECG. So is it okay if Brody and Mutant interprets it, and then we'll have you weigh in after?
Absolutely.
Hi, everyone. This is Brody. Hi, Karin. Hi, Gurleen. Nice to meet you guys. Okay, let me just go. It's not very super clear on my screen, and I'm seeing from a bad screen, though. Yeah. So I'll try. So it seems like, the rhythm seems almost regular to me. There's a P and there's a Q after that. And the P and the P in V1 and lead one, they look all, I'm not very able to, I can't appreciate easily the two parts of the P, but they look same. And the Q is narrow and seems like it's a good length. And then going to the ST, it's definitely There appears to be a little bit of an elevation. There's definitely a scooping in most of the leads. And I'm not very sure, I didn't catch the medications history and stuff, but and then the tea looks the tea. So I'm trying to put this together. So definitely I feel it's a sinus rhythm, and I'm thinking most of the thing which is coming to my mind is a repolarization abnormality, and which probably could be from an ischemia, though I'm having a tough time putting it exactly where the ischemia is. Okay, one more thing. Okay, the axis looks like it's fine. AVL seems to be the biphasic axis, is probably the axis seems okay. So yeah, I'm exactly in the chat. I'm thinking if he's on digoxin, and those are my thoughts. It's pretty rough. I'm not very good at this, but would love to hear your thoughts.
And what was your name?
It's Brody.
Brody, you know, you're being tough on yourself. I'm glad you went through it, and you went systematically through it. I think you picked up on a lot of the things here. You know, when an EKG is presented to you, obviously we are going to go about it systematically, but we have this information that there is VFib, a troponin of 240, an extensive coronary vascular disease. So the burden of proof when we interpret this EKG is, of course, not in isolation. It's another diagnostic tool when our pretest probability of coronary disease is extremely high. So I like how there are these segments that somewhat look like they're scooping, but the pretest probability of coronary disease is so, so high for this patient. So one of the things that you pointed out, and you can't see my arrow, but I agree that this is a normal P wave access. The QRS is narrow. The access of the vector depolarization is normal, but it's this subtle ST elevation in AVR, the subtle ST elevation in V1. It's not quite fitting criteria, and there's this diffuse ST depression. Now, while it is somewhat looks scooped, it's somewhat horizontal here, V5, V6, and 2, 3, AVF, and it may be that the segment is beginning to try to elevate in V2 as well. But when I see this, and I see this diffuse pattern of what looks like ST depression and a subtle elevation in AVR, some people consider that a STEMI equivalent. And it's not quite a STEMI equivalent. What it tends to be is when that happens, some people think of it as a left main disease or a proximal LAD. What's more commonly when they look at the literature is that there's a diffuse three vessel disease. Diffuse three vessel disease with some type of insult that leads to diffuse subendocardial ischemia. And you have to remember, AVR is not a typical, it's an augmented lead. It doesn't exist as an actual lead in our frontal plane. So it is a vector where it's suggesting that the ST is elevating AVR and the diffuse ST elevation elsewhere that tends to indicate that there's extensive coronary involvement. Now, I don't see clear signs that there's this pericarditis. You know, perimyocarditis can sometimes present like this. We didn't hear any prodrome for this, and the troponin is quite, quite elevated. So from the point that we started, VFib arrest, elderly gentleman, multiple cardiovascular risk factors, troponin 240, I'm localizing the pathology for the VFib arrest to the coronaries. I'm highly concerned that there's either three vessel disease or proximal left main or LAD disease. And based on this, my initial questions were, does the patient need to go to the cath lab? Does the patient need mechanical support? My initial impression is that I think the patient needs to go to the cath lab. I would take them emergently. And I do not think, based on initially what we have, that necessarily the patient needs mechanical support. Though the lactate was elevated, there was evidence of liver injury. There could be some signs that there's developing congestion. We didn't hear about an exam. But that's my initial impressions. And Brody, thank you for going through the EKG.
Thank you so much. Yeah, you explained beautifully. Thanks.
Great. So some more information after the EKG. So it did, what you guys said was basically what the read had said at that time. And then he also had an EKG at when he presented to our institution, and it was pretty similar to before. There was no significant changes or progression. In terms of some more information, so he was initiated on targeted temperature management when he came into our institution because of his cardiac arrest and the other aspects. And then at that time, his physical exam, his blood pressure was 105 over 59, pulse was 80. And then his respiratory rate was 32 and he was ventilated. In terms of other physical exam, he was intubated, sedated, and paralyzed. His JVP was hard to appreciate. According to this is the physical exam that was on admission to our hospital. Cardiovascular, regular rate and rhythm, normal S1-S2, no murmurs were heard. He had no significant lower extremity edema and no other abnormalities on the physical exam. And then right as he kind of got to our hospital, he became very tachycardic. And I have an image of the tachycardia on the telemetry. If Daniela, you want to share that image.
And Scarlina, as you're pulling it up, you know, the exam that you described, again, my questions are cath lab, mechanical support, you know, what's the etiology of this? Is there a trigger? I think the etiology is acute coronary event. Now, when you describe that exam, my other question was, is this patient going to need mechanical support? You said a ventilated, sedated, paralyzed patient with a respiratory rate of 32. So unless we set that respiratory rate at 32, this patient is demonstrating signs of pulmonary congestion that's developing, even though your exam did not describe it. And even if there's no murmurs, acute ischemic MR, which would be the most common murmur, and this probably not the case because it's a little way too acute for it unless the patient had a vessel that was providing a single supply or to the posterior lateral wall, it can certainly not manifest. And that now you have the EKG up or the. Do you want someone to go through it or did you want me to take a review it?
Brodo, you did a great job with the EKG if you wanted to go over the telemetry, but no pressure if you don't want to.
Oh, sure. Yeah. It seems like, okay. So it was going all fine, but then there was this abrupt PVC, which kind of probably did a break in the, you know, probably would have caused a conduction break and degenerated the patient to what seems to be, I can't really make sure. It's from coming from the point that this is only an S segment with not a Q and an R. Sorry, there's no R and S, and there's only S. So I would say this is a ventricular tachycardia. So I think that PVC would have initiated this probably. I'm not very sure.
No, that's excellent, Brody. And one of the things that I immediately think is, even if I didn't see the telemetry strip, if someone gave me that history and Gerlene came and said, this is a wide complex tachycardia in an elderly gentleman, V-fib arrest, troponin 240, the pretest probability again is through the roof that this is ventricular tachycardia. So even without looking at the telemetry strip, you tell me it's wide complex tachycardia, the burden of proof to say that this is not VT is extremely high. Now, I don't know the exact number what the pretest probability that this is VT is, but I would put it above 95%. And so you went through a couple of things there, some criteria. There's multiple different criteria. There's the Brugada criteria amongst being the most common things here. Yes, there certainly is, I see in the chat people mentioning that there are PVCs occurring. And then you can see around the beat number 7 when this starts to take off. One of the things that with a wide complex tachycardia, very quickly, when I'm trying to think through what's happening there, my first question is, who's the patient? If they have a history of structural heart disease, coronary disease, with a wide complex tachycardia, they have a history of cardiomyopathy, again, the pretest probability is extremely high that it's VT. Do they have a pulse or no pulse? Because that's going to immediately going to drive us down our ACS algorithm. Are they stable or unstable? And then maybe you have some time to actually apply some of the Bugrada criteria or whatever criteria you use. And those criteria really ask three main questions. And the main three questions that ask, what is the atrioventricular relationship? What is the vector of ventricular activation? Is it that it's starting at the top of the heart in the atria, the base of the heart, and coming down? Or is it starting in the ventricles and going up? And the final question is the conduction through the specialized tissue, conduction system tissue, or is it myocyte to myocyte interactions? So very briefly, when we're trying to interrogate the AV relationship, what you're looking for is AV dissociation. And Brody, I think that's what you tried to mention there. You know, it's hard when you're going at a rate that looks like close to 180, 190 based on the telemetry here. When you're going that fast, it's really hard sometimes to define the AV relationship and see if there are P waves marching out through the QRS complex. Are there less Ps than QRS? And one of the clues that may help you identify when you see a six-lead telemetry here is if you see a fusion beat or a capture beat, which is when there's atrial activation with some activation of the myocardium and a ventricular activation at the same time, and those causes a fusion beat. The next thing that, again, after we interrogate the AV relationship, I'm looking to see what is the direction of activation through the QRS. Now, yeah. typically, with VT, you will see that the initial vector of activation should be positive in AVR. It's a little unusual that this lead, that the AVR, that it's pointing negative. That's not going to be a slam dunk just because it's not the initial activation in AVR is negative. Is not going to sway me away from thinking that's VT, but that's one of the quick and dirty clues that you would try to define whether someone is in ventricular tachycardia. Then there's morphologic criteria. There's something called concordance across the precordium, meaning is it all an R wave or is it all an S wave, which is again gives an idea of the level of activation. And then if you do truly have time, and it's hard on here, you look at what the initial part of the QRS looks like. So when your other, amongst your other differentials for a Y complex tachycardia between VT, VF, V flutter, is this SVT with aberrancy? Is this a pre-excited tachycardia? And when you're trying to differentiate that, a rhythm that starts from the atria, let's say an SVT with aberrancy, still goes through the conduction system. It still goes through the bundle branch. It still goes through the His-Purkinje system. And that conduction system is 10 times faster than conduction when you go myocyte to myocyte. And so what some of the criteria will point out is trying to see how long that initial deflection of an R wave in V1 is, or S wave, or how long it takes from the start of the QRS to get to the nadir of the QRS complex. Normally, if you have gone down the normal conduction system, meaning you supraventricular tachycardia with aberrancy, that initial component of the QRS will be less than 60 milliseconds. If you're going myocyte to myocyte conduction, it's going to be prolonged. And that initial part of the QRS, from the start of the QRS to the nadir, is going to be longer. And I think the Brugada criteria says greater than 100 milliseconds. So that's how I try to interrogate this. First things first, without even looking at the EKG or the telemetry strip, who's the patient, stable, unstable, or pulse, no pulse, stable, unstable. And then I go through what's the AV relationship, what's the, are the morphologic criteria, and what's that initial component of the QRS. I can't definitively say where this is initiating from, but I believe this patient has gone into monomorphic VT at this time, which a lot of times we think is scar-based, but it can occur in the setting of acute ischemia.
Well, thanks.
Yeah, that was great. I don't have a formal EKG from that time, but the EKG at that time, a formal one, did show monomorphic VT. So he had an episode sustained VT, received compressions, was started on amio and lidocaine, and then he also became hypotensive to the 80s or 50s and required levofed and vasopressin. And then the next piece of information as I have is an echo that was on the day of admission to our hospital, and it showed mild concentric left ventricular hypertrophy with an increase in the left ventricular wall thickness. LV systolic function was moderately impaired, with the LV diffusely hypokinetic EF of 30%. RV systolic function was mildly decreased, and there was aortic stenosis that was defined as moderate.
Okay, Gerline, that is some excellent information here. You know, to me, this patient, again, when we started, I said, the first things that are coming through my mind are cath lab, mechanical support, as some of the things that I immediately think about when I hear that a patient presented with VFib arrest out in the field. And my initial thought was, yes, this patient needs a cath lab, and I would do it sooner rather than later. You know, there's some trials that go through the timing of non-STEMI cath lab activation. There's something called a COAC trial, and there's a recent New England Journal paper, the Tomahawk trial. You know, cardiology always comes up with these fun names for trial, Tomahawk, what a name. Anyway, and they said if there was there wasn't evidence of STEMI, you know, delayed activation of the cath lab was a reasonable approach. To me, there is enough concern that there's an occlusive MI that the patient should go to the cath lab as soon as possible. The second question was mechanical support. You're describing someone that has hypotension, is on Levofed, and now also requiring vasopressin. So on a hefty dose probably of Levofed to maintain their blood pressure. And you have to remember in acute MI, one of the first things that you may manifest before you actually manifest a decreased or increased SVR, if you're heading towards cardiogenic shock by SVR, I mean systemic vascular resistance, is you have a very large pro-inflammatory state. So you can really drop your blood pressure from profound vasodilation initially as well. And so why the patient may have required norepinephrine, vasopressin amongst their manifestations. And then you describe an EF of 30%, not necessarily saying if there is a wall motion abnormality or not. A wall motion abnormality may have pointed us to a specific territory. Diffusely decreased with global hypokinesis. Now, could this be a manifestation that there's really proximal disease, like in the left main coronary artery? Is this stunned myocardium from the multiple shocks that the patient has achieved? And you've also mentioned that there's RV dysfunction. So there's some level of global hypokinesis. I take it back to when I said I'm really localizing to the coronaries here. And when you describe global dysfunction and the possible diagnosis of pneumonia, you know, you still think about, could this be myocarditis? Diffusely thickened walls is usually the first manifestation of myocarditis. But with a patient with coronary disease, history of aortic stenosis, hypertension, that left ventricular hypertrophy seems to have other clear culprits. And the troponin of 240 really doesn't make sense for this patient's acute presentation the way he presented, especially without any significant prodrome. Now, you gave us a lot of information on the echo. It's there. One of the really important factors and is prognostic on it, and as you look at echocardiograms and read the reports, is really pay attention to what the Doppler says. And what that Doppler is basically, it is specifically of the mitral valve. And I won't get into too much details there, but it's basically trying to give you an idea of what the heart is doing in terms of filling pressures. And those numbers can be really prognostic in an acute myocardial infarction. And so I utilize that information as well to help guide whether the patient's going to need mechanical support. But at this time, I think this patient had an acute coronary event. From that acute coronary event, I do think he's manifesting some evidence of left main or proximal LAD disease versus diffuse three vessel disease. And I think the patient needs to go to the cath lab and probably will need mechanical support to get through this acute event.
Yeah, that's great. So in terms of interval events, I don't know, I'm not exactly clear of like some of the timeline because I took care of him at a later stage, but he was not taken to the cath lab immediately. He was, I think some of the discussions in the notes were that his troponin elevation initially had been related to kind of post-arrest myocardial injury, as well as that could be causing some of his vasoplegia or his hypotension. And he was able to kind of come off of some of those pressors. And it was more of like an acute needing when he like required them. And then he did eventually get a left heart cath, but it was on hospital day 11. And it showed moderate coronary artery disease with 70% stenosis of the RCA, 40% of the left circumflex, and 80% of the second diagonal. And there was no acute or subacute occlusion. And I don't have the exact troponins from our hospital, but they did, they were lower when he had come from the outside emergency department. And at the time he got the left heart cath, he also had a right heart cath, and it showed RA pressure was 7/5, RV was 28/3, the wedge was 13, pulmonary artery was 22/10, and his FIC, his cardiac index, was 2.74. And then I have another aliquot after this before the final diagnosis.
You know, that again, that's highly surprising to me when you find those results, but I still think the thought process and the way of going about it is consistent with the patient's pretest probability. Extensive cardiovascular disease history, has a VFib arrest, there's some subtle evidence of potential elevation in AVR and V1, with diffuse ST depression. And that troponin, again, really points to a coronary event. But now, you know, you've taken to a left heart cath and you see that the patient doesn't have at least significant coronary disease to explain this event in this EF. And then you also evaluate the patient with a right heart cath and you demonstrate they don't have extensive filling pressures. So what happened here, I have to go back to what could have caused that original event, that original arrest, and thinking about that sudden cardiac arrest. And again, the categories were the underlying pathology. Could it be coronary disease? And we're not necessarily seeing that. And I didn't hear, at least on the cath, that it wasn't another form of coronary disease, like spontaneous coronary artery dissection, that there wasn't an anomalous coronary, that there wasn't evidence that the patient had an embolism or arteritis. So we're going to leave it at those things. But remember, if sometimes when there's reported no occlusion, there could still be spontaneous coronary dissection. It just may not look like angiographically that there's evidence of coronary disease. So then going back to the cardiomyopathy, I don't know how long ago that initial echo was, Gerline, when the patient first, was it 4 or 5? I think it was that year,
the right? The echo was, the previous echo was around like a year and a half before.
Okay. So is it possible that the patient between now and then developed a cardiomyopathy? And I don't know if you described it as a dilated now, and it certainly is possible. And there's multiple reasons why the patient could have developed a cardiomyopathy, and the EF is not necessarily any worse than maybe it was 3 or 4 months ago. What points me a little bit against that is the patient was doing quite well. There's no reported that he had developed signs of congestion over time or exercise fatigue or dyspnea. He had reported some claudication. So then the amongst the cardiomyopathy, the other things you think about is, did this patient, did he develop myocarditis? Is that pneumonia a manifestation of diffuse myocarditis? And did the patient have some level of myopericarditis? And maybe we're not necessarily seeing a significant pericardial effusion on the echo. Amongst the things that can cause myocarditis, of course, there are viral syndromes. This is at the time of COVID. We didn't hear necessary respiratory symptoms. The diagnosis of COVID myocarditis is brought into question quite a bit. You know, direct viral injury to the myocytes and leading to lymphocytic infiltrates is really not borne out in autopsy reports, but could this have been a way that a stress cardiomyopathy manifested, or that there's some diffuse inflammation, cytokine storm? Things pointing against that, though, is that, you know, really not describing someone with significantly deranged vitals over time. It was a short period and resolved. Could this be a patient that has a substrate for another reason? You know, could they have some underlying cardiomyopathy that's not really matter? You didn't really describe the walls very thick. You know, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy can still present in elderly age. You don't always present in the young. We catch a lot of these patients. And then the final bit there is you reported the moderate aortic stenosis. So that moderate aortic stenosis in the setting of a low EF could actually be more milder. So when you think about it, aortic stenosis is really related to the gradients that come across the valve. And if you don't have a pump that can push very hard across that valve, then maybe the gradients won't manifest as high. And part of that goes into equation calculating the aortic valve area may seem milder. So I don't think the aortic stenosis is a big part of it, but now as this twist in this, what this patient's cath and so forth showed, I'm beginning to think about whether the patient actually did develop a myocarditis, that they have an underlying dilated or idiopathic cardiomyopathy that forms a substrate to lead to VTVF. The channelopathies seem less on my differential there. That wasn't a typical Brugada pattern that you had demonstrated to me in that EKG. You know, it didn't demonstrate like a significantly long QT. It was prolonged, but a channelopathy at this age as an initial presentation seems unusual. And I didn't hear any history of toxins, meds, electrolytes, and so forth. So I'm trying to narrow towards whether this patient developed a VTVF from an underlying cardiomyopathy that just hadn't been diagnosed for some time, or they truly did develop myocarditis, but it seems a little unusual because there aren't other features of the myocarditis that are present here for this patient.
Yeah, that's really helpful. I'm learning so much by hearing you discuss and go through all this information. So the last piece of information I have is, so they, after the cath, they thought it was most likely like non-ischemic in terms of his presentation. So he had a cardiac MRI done on day 15, which was a couple of days after his cath. And that showed, I think around that time, he also had an echo done, which showed recovery of his ejection fraction to 55%. And just the cardiac MRI that he got, it showed a large amount of patchy mid-myocardial late gadolinium enhancement throughout the basal segments, more pronounced in the basal anterior, anteroseptal, and infraseptal walls. And there was also dense late gadolinium enhancement in the superior and inferior right ventricular insertion points in the basal and mid-ventricular segments. And overall, the result, the interpretation of this MRI was that the findings were suggestive of a non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, highly suspicious for cardiac sarcoidosis based on its infiltrative pattern. And this is the last aliquot before the final diagnosis.
That's a great tool to utilize to help when you don't have an etiology. Now you mentioned cardiac sarcoid. You know, cardiac sarcoid can manifest in and itself of any other extra cardiac manifestations, but it's not common. You know, patients with sarcoid, I think I believe 20%, 20-25% will manifest with sarcoid alone. I think it's a piece of information that doesn't fit necessarily everything else about the patient's story. And so we have to make sure that that one piece of diagnostic information fits what the story is, and could it actually present this way in a typical sarcoid presentation. And I say that typical sarcoid presentation because there isn't really a typical sarcoid presentation. So this certainly could be a manifestation of cardiac sarcoid, but let's make sure that we don't, on that MRI, have other evidence that it's not another diagnosis. Now, if this was coronary disease, you would have expected subendocardial late gadolinium enhancement, that patchy, diffuse enhancement throughout the mid-myocardium, especially that basal interventricular septum and the inferior wall is pretty specific for cardiac sarcoid. You know, on echo, sometimes you can see it as well, the mid and basal walls, though global involvement can occur as well. And that's kind of what we saw here. And sarcoid can also lead to diffuse thickness, which is certainly a possibility for contributing to the why that patient's ventricular hypertrophy was increased. Now, if a biopsy was done on this patient, we may see that the patient did have granulomas and that was characteristic of that nature, but that cardiac MRI is highly, highly suspicious for it. Now, the next step may be to do an FDG PET to see if there are focal active lesions that, and seemingly with the manifestation of VFib, VTAC, certainly there could be some concern that there would be manifestation of it. Going back to that EKG, what's a little also unusual for this patient to have cardiac sarcoid, I don't believe that I saw a bundle branch block on it or the QRS was widening. You know, sometimes we begin to think that the patient had would have manifested some level of conduction delay with cardiac sarcoid. It wasn't a hit of, you know, it starts right now and then suddenly presents that day. So again, parts of this seem a little unusual for a cardiac sarcoid, but that seems to be the diagnosis being put together by the MRI, hardly diagnostic tool. And because there isn't a typical necessarily presentation of cardiac sarcoid, it certainly could fit it. So what happened from there, Darlene?
I love that discussion of how sometimes diagnostic tests and the things that we see on them are not necessarily what might be like the underlying diagnosis. You have to consider all the other aspects of evidence, like of the presentation, and not just rely on the imaging. So he did end up getting a cardiac sarcoid PET scan, and there was no evidence of active myocardial inflammation. There were some like pulmonary nodules and ground glass opacities that were seen, as well as some consolidative opacities related to the similar to the chest scan that was done before, which were consistent with possible like aspiration or also some like pneumonia. And they did see some mediastinal nodes that were active, but they thought they were likely reactive and inflammatory in nature. So the workup overall, the assessment of this imaging study was that there was no clear evidence for sarcoidosis or other infiltrative heart disease, though myocarditis would be difficult to exclude. So I feel like it's a non-climatic end to this case, but I thought it was an interesting case to share because I feel like there's so many data points that we get in cardiology and imaging studies, but sometimes taking the bigger picture into account and kind of thinking through the pretest probability is really helpful. So he did well, like throughout his hospitalization in terms of like his cardiac arrest. He was eventually able to be extubated, had completed the temperature management earlier on, and did have neurological recovery and did well and was able to kind of get back to like in terms of his mental status and improve. And he was discharged, and on discharge, the team had recommended consider genetic screening for arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy, but ultimately there was no like specific diagnosis of the cardiomyopathy, and it was kind of just thought to be non-ischemic. That's what the discharge summary said. I only took care of him for like a part of his hospitalization, but yeah, so there was no sarcoidosis.
And Darlene, did he receive a defibrillator?
Yes, he on discharge, he did get a dual chamber ICD placed. Okay. Yeah. And then, yeah, by discharge, his EF had recovered to 55 to 60%.
You know, a couple things, you know, like you said, some of the data points fit, some don't. I would have, when this happens, you know, in the catheterization lab, especially if the patient is now day 10, day 11 from the initial event doing well, you know, was really trying to spend some time in the catheterization lab reviewing the angiographic films to see, is there any evidence of dissection, but also doing maneuvers to see, can we induce coronary vasospasm, even considering IVUS imaging, intravascular ultrasound, to see if you can define the pathology a little bit better. Because, you know, I agree with you that last point where, again, the late gadolinium and mid myocardium tends to be pretty specific for myocarditis and not ischemia, but everything else points towards ischemia for this patient and not necessarily myocarditis or sarcoid or another manifestation. You know, you could have giant cell myocarditis, which is a full mitten usually presentation. So I'd like what Darlene you said there, and you tend to teach me more than I get a chance to teach you, is that there is I really have to go back to your original data and don't let the diagnostic test along the pathway of making a diagnosis in cardiology completely veer you off course if it really doesn't fit what your initial thought process is.
Yeah, thank you so much for the discussion. And what you said is not true. I learn a lot more from you. And with that, we'll turn it to Rafa to take it home with our teaching points for today.
First, thank you, Berlin, for presenting such an incredible case. And thank you, Karen, for taking your time and be with us in this awesome hour. So we have these elderly patients with chest pain progressing to cardiac arrest And then we saw that cardiac arrest is actually defined by sudden cessation of cardiac activity with hemodynamic collapse. And this is typically due to sustained ventricular tachycardia or ventricular fibrillation, but we have to go after the cause of the sudden cardiac death. And there are many etiologies that could be involved, especially coronary artery disease being the most common cause. Also cardiomyopathy, like stress-induced cardiomyopathy, dilated cardiomyopathy, genoopathies, especially in young patients with an episode of syncope during exercise, toxins like cocaine, but also medication side effects like TCA, electrolyte abnormalities, myocarditis, and also congenital coronary artery anomalies. And then when it comes to sustained ventricular arrhythmia, we have to remember that this is mostly common due to acute ST elevation MI, but less commonly seen in patients with unstable angina or acute non-ST elevation MI. And then we went through the rhythms with long QRS versus narrow QRS, and then it was reminded to us that the narrow QRS, it's actually the region of the rhythm is supraventricular, plus there is no bundle bridge block. If this is a long QRS, we have to remember that the region of the rhythm is probably ventricular, because an intact QRS requires two things, a supraventricular rhythm, but also an intact His per Kinch system. And then in the end, we discussed a little bit about cardiac sarcoidosis. The most common clinical manifestations include atrial ventricular block, arrhythmias, heart failure, and sudden cardiac death. And then we can see on the histology if we do a biopsy, non-caseating granulomas. So thank you, everyone. Hope everyone had a good time, and I hope to see everyone tomorrow.